give him all the praise this morning. It all belongs to him. The writer said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. In the house there is healing, there is deliverance, there's the power. Well, I guess there's already distraction in the house, but there's also a God who's in the house, amen. No matter what we're going through this morning, God's going to do something that much greater. If we thought that was loud, there's going to be a louder sound of chains falling down, of walls falling down, of miracles taking place. There's going to be a cry into heaven this morning of a people who knows that their God is listening, that their God hears them, that their God will make a way out of no way. This is still a church of faith. This is still a church of miracles. This is still a church where the blood still makes a way out of your situation, out of your circumstance and your issues. Is there a cry in the house this morning to a God who's going to do it? Who's going to make a way out of no way? Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Oh, let's worship him, church.
Oh God, we come to lift you up this morning, Jesus. We've come to magnify your name. We've come to lift up the only name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Somebody put your hands together. We lift our hands.
We lift our hands in the sanctuary. We lift our hands.
We clap our hands.
We clap our hands.
There's victory in the house.
Clap our hands.
I wrote about your love, I'd run out of paper. If I sang about your mercies, I'd run out of breath.
There's not enough paint in the world to paint a picture of your splendor. There's not enough words to describe the awesome wonder of your power.
Of your power. Your mercy's ocean deep. Your love is where I want to be. Your grace is more than I could ever believe. Your mercy. Ocean deep, your love is where I want to be. Your grace is more than I could ever believe. If I wrote about your love,
oh, I'd run out of paper.
Run out of paper.
If I sang
about your mercy,
oh, I'd run out of breath.
Let it overflow.
Pour out your overflow.
Let it overflow.
Oh, pour out your spirit.
Pour out your love.
Let it overwhelm me.
Oh, let it overflow.
Oh, God, it's your grace. It's your
love.
That's why I'm standing here today. But it's of your mercy. It's of your goodness, God. Your grace.
Your
love, God.
Your love.
Oh, your mercy, Jesus.
Your mercy.
Oh,
let it overwhelm me.
Your grace.
Your love.
Your mercy, Jesus.
Your mercy.
Oh, your mercy, God. Where would I be without them?
Your love is where I want to be. Your grace is more than I could ever believe.
Somebody help me love him in the tabernacle. Lift your voice. Let's talk to him. Oh, the Holy Ghost is in the building. Talk to him. Hallelujah. Somebody lift those hands and just tell him, pour out your spirit, Lord. Pour out your love. Come on, somebody let that prayer well up inside of you. God can't heal us if he can't hear us. Somebody needs to talk to him on a Sunday morning. Lord, I showed up with a need today. Pour out your mercy today. Pour out your love today, Jesus. Oh, God, I want to be overwhelmed by your presence today. I want to be inundated with your love today. Anybody want more than a casual touch on a Sunday morning? I don't want to just know about him. I want to be inundated. Oh, oil, run over, cup, run over. Let it run over, let it run over. Let it run over, let it run over. I challenge you today to be inundated in the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is running like a deep river through this tabernacle today. But in the midst of God's moving that is supernatural, some of us are caught up in the culture of, I want to be a Christian, but I don't want to be inundated. Wonder if we can lift our hand one more time and say, Lord, overwhelm me. Ah, overwhelm me. It's here, church. It's here. Overwhelm me. I'm going through the motions, but I'm not overwhelmed yet. My cup is clean, but my cup is not overrunning. Come on, come to church on a Sunday morning. Get out of your religiosity. Get out of your little mundane culture. Ah, somebody call upon him. Pour out your love. Let it overwhelm me, Jesus. Let it overflow. Come on, pray it, pray it. Let that song bubble in your spirit. God, touch us today. Come on, just for a couple moments. Just for a couple moments, let's come to church. Woo! Pour out your spirit. Don't let it overflow. Somebody needs to call his name right here.
Pour out your spirit.
Pour out your love.
Pour out your love.
Say, let it
overwhelm me.
Oh, let it over.
Let it overflow.
Come on, it sounds good. Pour out.
Pour out your spirit.
On my marriage and my family.
Pour out your love.
Come on, somebody, get your strength right here. Oh, there's healing happening right here.
Pour out your spirit.
Tell him, pour out.
Pour out your love.
Hallelujah. He's working right here.
Let it overwhelm me.
Oh, let it over.
Let it overflow.
One more time. Tell him,
pour out your spirit.
Hold my hand.
Pour out your love.
Somebody help me love them. That's beautiful, church. You're walking in the Holy Ghost today. This is right. Hallelujah. There is angels round about me. I wish somebody believed that. There is a host encamped round about me. Oh, overwhelm me. I pray God would take the scales off our eyes today. There is more for us than against us, Hilltop. Hallelujah. Every addiction will be broken today. Every stronghold will come down today. Yes, yes. Because his mercy is oceans deep. It's a sea of forgetfulness. The God of all wisdom, infinite in his glory, eternal in his being, the end from the beginning, the author and the finisher, would throw my sin into a sea that is so deep he cannot even remember. I encourage you today to forget some things that Jesus has forgotten about you. I'm not the preacher today, but some of us are struggling with things that Jesus don't even remember.
You're in the house of God with condemnation. The writer said, there's therefore now no condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus. I invite you to be in today. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. I am deeply appreciative of the presence of God. It is a treasure that its value cannot be ascertained by men or world culture, governments, commerce. Cannot even fathom the value. I like how the psalmist said, better is one day in his courts than a thousand elsewhere. I wouldn't give you anything for a position that had no power. Because if it has no power, what kind of position is it? If we don't have his presence, we are none of his spirit. And so I want to be counted blessed, to be inundated and overwhelmed by his glory. There's a couple of announcements as the ushers are preparing the service today. After the service in the foyer, the Esther Conference, and I must say this, I have seen car tires painted bright pink. I'm not going to mention any names, but somebody has borrowed a grocery cart, and I don't know if the church owes Walmart or Ralph's. Yeah, or our brother Hobo down the road done lost his cart. Hey. I heard somebody told that brother, the master hath need. Hey, loose this cart. And so I have been smiling. And some of you, Brother Robles was in there. Thank you. Some of the men are helping. Brother Chris Buxton, Brother Thane Buxton. Many of these, I'm gonna miss names. Let's give them a hand, everybody that's working so hard. The Esther Committee, all of you great ladies helping. Thank you so much. Obviously, I'm a dude, but I'm impressed with the detail. And so, if I was not a dude, I'd be there. Pastor, I've been a couple times. Well, you haven't been this time. And this is gonna be the best time ever. And so I invite you to be there. I want to encourage all the ladies of Hilltop, bring your daughters that have already graduated and let them mentor. I don't want to be a momentary participator. I want to be a goal participator. And this is an endeavor to reach the world. We have missionaries flying from Germany to be here. I think you can drive 4 miles to be here. Somebody said amen. And so after service today, there's been a little bit of rain. And I know some people, obviously they had a little trouble hooking up the reindeer and the dog sleds to get through this Siberian spring storm. And we're praying for them that God would bless them and they can get the chains off their car to get here to the house of God tonight, brave the ice. We're believing the snow plows are gonna clear the roads. You might as well smile, it's funny. Sandy, it rains and people, you know, maybe they're getting a hold of Jesus and they're gonna be ready for tonight. That's a good thing. But we want to pray for all those that are unable to be here today. But after service, there is a cake auction. Now, this is not just any other auction. This is a dessert auction. Let me see your hand if you like dessert. Let's start this. Let me see. Hold them up. All right. Okay. God just saw that. So every hand that was up that just volunteered to be at the auction, because you like dessert and we're going to support this. Honey, this is going to be the best year ever, I can promise you. Because of the weather, if you could, right after service, we are going to not try to trap you, but we're going to get you in the foyer. And we got a tent set up. The great men that did that, God bless them. But the weather, it's a little wet outside. We are going to begin to bid on these cakes and desserts. If you've never been to one of these and fought somebody over chocolate chip cookies, this is perfect. After we pray through and our spirits are all right, we're going to have a bidding war over sugar, and that's a good thing. And so please come help us out. You don't want to miss this. All proceeds go to Esther's Conference, 100% of them, and this is a great, great cause. And so don't miss that. Also, our Spanish service, it's more than a service. It is a revival that hell hates. It's happening right here. Amen. Let's give them a great hand, brother and sister Asagueta. Doing a great job pastoring this. Amen. I'm proud of them, what they're doing, 7 p.m. Discipleship class every Tuesday at 7 p.m. simultaneously in the Family Life Center. This is not just for new converts. This is for old converts. Any old converts here today? I'm still converted. Hallelujah. Some of y'all catch that by tonight. And we invite you. If you haven't been through the Word of God in a long time, enroll in class. It's a great, great time. You don't want to miss it. Before we give, I want Brother Aaron Willis to come. This is our junior youth pastor, to give an announcement on Camp West.
Praise the Lord, everybody. I've come to give an announcement about Camp West. I guess I'm the only one excited about Camp West. I hear it's an incredible camp, and I can't wait to go. The dates are June 17th through the 21st. Brother Luke St. Clair is going to be preaching. I heard he's phenomenal. I can't wait. So you can register online at campwest.com. You go there, register. We'll have a separate registration for everybody that's going to pay for everything. We'll do fundraisers for everybody, make sure everything's covered, your gas, your food, the snack shack, because I know some of y'all are going to be wanting to go to the snack shack more than eat because of probably the Red Bulls and all that. I will be hyped up on Red Bulls the whole week because lack of sleep from all y'all. So, but can't wait. Can't wait to see who all's all going, and please register and let me know if you're going to go. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Brother Aaron, I don't think we should tell the parents that we're going to let their kids get Red Bull at camp. Praise God. Praise God. You've never seen an 11-year-old with a Red Bull in their hand. You hadn't been to camp. And Jesus, help us all. Amen. That's going to be a great time. I do want to double down on what he said. Parents, we know it's tough when you have two or three kids, and with prices being what they are, the youth pastors are working very hard to do fundraisers, to alleviate gas money and food money, and hopefully the tuition money. And I talked to them last week. We had a meeting, and they are interested in helping you because we understand it's a tough thing to send all of your kids. If you're like Brother Joseph and Sister Sobin, you got seven of them. It's hard at $200-$300 a pop. And so we're going to help y'all, Brother Jay. Amen. And you won't even have to drive your van, in Jesus' name. Somebody said amen. Brother Alex Yerushetta, I want you to come. And while he's coming, come join Pastor Day. I'm not going to get you, but we're going to surprise you a little bit today. Not only has he successfully completed every single course with perfect attendance of his Be Free course in class, let's give him a great hand. Hold it up. That's all right. Give him a good hand. The devil is a liar. I said the devil is a liar. Addictions have to break. Ooh, I feel the Holy Ghost. Cycles have to stop. For where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Stay up here for a second. You may be seated. I'm going to embarrass him a little bit further, but I want to say this from my heart. A couple months ago, in fact, he was laying on his back with a knee surgery. He said, Pastor, I have a burden to help around the house of God. You don't have to pay me. You don't have to give me anything. The only thing he wanted, he said, can I have a key to the house of God? And I begin to understand that key meant a whole lot more. And I've grown to understand what it means, Brother Yerushetta. But I want to thank Brother Yerushetta for he's already dove in, cutting back the invasive bamboo. And he's coming down here and he's giving of his time to make your church look beautiful. One more time, Brother Yerushetta, we appreciate you. Thank you for your labor.
I do appreciate it. I really do.
Amen. I appreciate him. In Jesus' name, if you're bored, don't have nothing to do, go see Brother Yerushetta, and he will give you some good marching orders. Why don't we stand? It's easier to give. Amen. While we're standing, so thankful for the blessings of God that maketh rich and full and addeth no sorrow. Tithe and offering are not the verbiage of the preacher. Tithe and offering are the revelation of God's people that are in his word. How many's got enough money? You don't need any more money. Let me see your hand. Okay. We got a couple brave souls. The rest of us mortals here today. Amen. How do we reach the world? God has to bless through us. God can't bless past us until he can bless through us. Amen. And so if you want God to bless you, and I know you do, amen, and the windows of heaven to be open, I want them on my family. I really do. I want them. I want to build churches, and I want to write the check. Come on, somebody. I don't want to have to wash cars if I don't have to. And I've done it. I don't want to have to make divinity and peanut brittle. And I've done it. I want to be so blessed. God, just tell me where to send the funds in Jesus' name. When we give to God and he blesses, we give him 10% of our tithe, 5% of our offering. That is biblical. When we give God that 15%, he presses it down. He shakes it together. And then it runs over into your life. Let's pray. Jesus, I don't give because I have to or I'm forced to. I brought my tithe and offering today, and Lord, I am blessed to do it. I'm thankful. I can't afford to not be blessed, and Lord, I sure don't deserve it. It's why when I pray like this, God, I'm so humbled that you would bless me in spite of me. Today, I pray, bless this incredible host, this church, this ecclesia called out people. Bless them. God, make us the head and not the tail. In Jesus' mighty name, and the church said amen. It's our custom to march from the back to the front. Let's come. Let's give. When you're done, shake somebody's hand. They're going to sing. Let's worship.
The whole earth is full of your glory.
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 You reign.
You reign.
You reign.
You reign.
Oh, what?
Jesus, King of all kings, Lord of all lords. Come on, sing his praises. The heavens declare his glory, his handiwork, his beauty. Let the church declare how great is our God, beautiful in his splendor. Remain standing today. We are doubly honored to have Brother Harris here. His little daughters are probably happy. It's all right. Give him a hand. He deserves it. Give his wife a hand. She really deserves it. She's the one doing all the work. Isn't that right, Sister Harris? Praise God. I got an amen today. Amen. Amen. And what Mama says is what is true. Praise God. We're so thankful. I'm grateful today as he's preparing to come for the DNA of my father. I have not just my heavenly father, but my earthly father, who was my dad before he was the great man of God that he is, and our bishop. And it's very unique for me, and it's probably one of the most dear things to me, is to see his DNA come through the sonship of the gospel. And there is no greater representation of just that than Evangelist Nathaniel Harris, who is a seasoned man of God in his own right. And I appreciate that he's not a hireling. He is not a young man in the ministry anymore. He's getting kind of old, long in the tooth. But the hand of God is heavy upon him, and he's one of my dearest friends, and I'm glad he's home. Like it was your last time, Brother Harris, preach.
Come on, let's give the Lord another hand clap of praise. Come on, somebody give that to God. He's worthy to receive all praise, honor, and glory. Come on, would you let him know he's welcome in the house this morning? Come on, would you let him know he's welcome in the house today? Oh, we love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. What an honor and a privilege it always is to be home, to be behind this sacred desk. Give Pastor and First Lady honor today. Amen. I love that when you walk into the house of the Lord, that there is and always has been a spirit of excellence that is in this house. And you can walk down seeing the remodel and all that's being done. In fact, I told pastors, you walk down the hallway and it's like walking down the most esteemed museum that you've ever been in. Amen. It's beautiful. It should be that way when you come to the house of God. People that take pride in the things of the Lord. Amen. And what a great, great, great God we serve. Amen. Mariah, Monroe, and Nathaniel told me, they said, you're going to my church. Monroe said, I'm going to sing. Mariah said she's going to play the keyboard, and little Bubba said he's playing the drums. Praise God. So we're going to have church one way or another today. Amen, amen, amen. I'll direct your attention to Acts chapter 9, starting in verse 1. Amen. Acts chapter 9 and verse 1. Love this church. Thank God for its great heritage. Thank you for your prayers. And for the record, I pay good child support. Thank you, Mama. Acts chapter 9 and verse 1. And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and desired of him letters to Damascus, to the synagogues, that if he found any of this way, whether they were men or women, he might bring and bound unto Jerusalem. And as he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven. And he fell to the earth and heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecute thou me? And he said, Who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And he was trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? And the Lord said unto him, Arise and go into the city, and it shall be told to thee what thou must do. And I'd like to preach to us this morning off this simple topic, when the puppet sees the strings. When the puppet sees the strings. Heavenly Father, we love you. God, we thank you for your great spirit that's in this house today. Thank you for meeting us here. God, you know every need before we make mention of it. And I'm asking you, God, to help us and meet the needs of your body today. Thank you for our precious church. Thank you, God, for a safe place in an unsafe world. Thank you, God, for your congregants, precious saints of God, guest friends and visitors that are here today. I'm asking you, God, to talk to us. I'm asking you, God, to let your word go forth. Minister like only you can. God, we're going to be careful to give you all the praise and all the glory and all the honor. Would you put your hands together again? Let's give God all the praise here today. Come on, let's give God all the honor that's in this room. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Amen, amen, amen. You may be seated in the house of the Lord this morning. Amen. There is much we can learn when we begin to read about the Apostle Paul. There's a lot about his life. From the ordinary, Paul was given the opportunity to do extraordinary things for the kingdom of God. The story of Paul is a story of redemption in Jesus Christ, and really a testimony that there is no one beyond saving of our Lord and Savior. This is a man who gains full measure, a man of a critic of the things of God. He's a man, if we are going to look at the attributes and the blessings of this man, we also could take a look at the dark side of Paul by the name of Saul. It is this man, this apostle of grace, but Paul's early life was marked by religious zeal, and one that was a man accompanied by brutal violence and relentless in persecuting the early church. Unfortunately, later in Paul's life, we can see the contrast of what began to happen. But when we look at that early life, we can talk about a man that was born. He was born in Tarsus of Cilicia, around a little after the beginning of AD. It is this Paul that was born in the province, in the southernmost corner of that area of not commonly now called Turkey. He was a Benjaminite, the lineage of the Hebrew ancestry. We can find that in Philippians 3, talking about his parents who were both Pharisees and fervent Jewish nationalists who adhered strictly to the law of Moses and who sought to protect, amen, their children against the contamination of all of the Gentiles. It's everything that was Greek that they would have despised. Anything that would come from that lineage or lamb, the people and the nation in which Paul was raised in would have to look down their nose. And even though he could speak a little bit of Greek and pass by with a little bit of Latin, his household mostly spoke Aramaic and the derivative of the Hebrew language. It's this man, at the age of 13, Saul was sent to Judea to learn under the great rabbi. It's here that he would be taught by the master teacher and learn a lot about Jewish history. He would learn about the Psalms and the works of the prophet. He would be educated above most of his day and his hour. And yet with all the teaching that was going on in the life of Paul, there was still just a little bit lacking of what revelation was to come in the future of his life. In fact, it was this man that he began to study under the tutelage that would show up when Peter is being in prison. And there was a man that would show up and begin to quiet the crowd down. It was Gamaliel that would, amen, be who Paul would study under. And there they would begin to, amen, talk to the Sanhedrin and the Jewish Supreme Court, if you will, those 71 men, and talk to them down from their judgment and stoning Peter. And yet with all, amen, that began to transpire, it is possible also that when, amen, Stephen is in court, that Paul is also there hearing the words that are going forth. We understand that Peter, or rather Paul, was there when Stephen was being stoned. But all this is in the name of the gospel in which he thought he was serving. It was this apostle Paul that would go on his own evangelistic campaigns in destroying people. He went walking into worshiping tabernacles and sanctuaries that were filled with people of worship. And he began to have, amen, decrees in our opening text, asking the men of their day that if he could just bind them, drag them back to the court system, and begin to judge them for their actions. This is a man that was doing all these things, so he thought, in the name of God. And so it is when we look at the life of this man, there were strings attached to this man of God. A man that had a great future, but had a lot of strings attached to him as he thought he was working in the fulfillment of the will of God for his life. The Bible is very clear that we serve, amen, only one master. The Bible is emphatic, amen, that you cannot serve two masters. That means if you are not serving the Lord, then you are serving the adversary. And what Paul did not understand is while he had a righteous indignation, and while he felt like he was doing something compassionate for the things of God, what he was really being led by was the strings of the adversary. He would use, amen, what his heart's desire to do something for God. But with lack of understanding and education on revelation of God, he would use what little bit of truth he had, amen, to, amen, frustrate the kingdom of God. And how many people do we know today, amen, that try their best, amen, for the benefit of the doubt to live a life above sin? We meet people that tell us all the time, amen, that they have a walk with God, maybe even a prayer life. But really, amen, when it comes to biblical scripture, they're illiterate because they cannot see the revelation of what God has in their life. In fact, you will watch it. I have never seen it in all, amen, of our days like we're seeing it right now on social media. Every day there's somebody else coming out with a channel. I'm talking about how they got revelation that they don't need oneness anymore. You're seeing women that are getting on there and talking about how holiness was such a bondage to them. And now they've got revelation for the first time in their life. And all they're doing is kicking against the pricks of the things of God. I'm going to work this for just a moment. But amen, today we live in a world that while in my father's day, I remember going to many weekend revivals with my dad, and he was known at one point or another for being the man that would cast out devils. I remember that we would go to several revivals back when you would grab the kids and run them off to a back room, and they would bring out a trash can. And I don't want to scare the guests here today, but hey man, those were some days and hours where it seemed like demonic oppression was at an all-time high. And physical manifestations happened many different services. And I could tell you some very strange things that I saw as a young man. But while the world is falling biblical, amen, perspective, the world is waxing worse and worse. There is not less demons in the world today than there was in the early traveling days of my father. There are not less, amen, demonic forces at work today than there was when I was a child. The only difference is there's a little bit more domestication of devils. Now devils put on suit and ties and come to church. Well, I didn't want to make your neighbor, amen, nervous or wake you all up at the same time this morning. But I want to help you now. Now there's people that go to work and they're cordial with you. And they say, how you doing? Had a good day. But they want to argue everything you believe from sun up to sun down and make you question what God has put in your life. I want to tell you there's some strings attached to that. I want to tell you that the great puppet master is not God. Amen. Because he will not force his will on anybody. But the great puppet master is the adversary, and he begins to put his hooks in the people and begins to manipulate them into working in areas. And there's people that come to apostolic church services that they don't even know, but the whole time they're there to create a distraction. They're there to question every one of your motives. They're there to ask you, do you really believe what's being preached? I've come to tell you, Paul had no idea. He thought he was doing the will of God. He thought he was pursuing, but there was a little bit of
strings that were attached to his life. I've come to preach to people in this room today that before we leave this service, I believe the puppet needs to look back and see the strings and realize the devil has been playing games with me. You thought it was your own intuition. You thought it was you and your doubt. But what was really happened was the adversary was working on your mind, had working on your home, had working on your family, and he was pulling the string here and pulling the string there. Amen. I want to preach to you today. You need those strings cut. I want to preach to people in this room. He who the Son has set free, it's got to be free indeed. I've come to preach to a Paul. I've come to preach to a Saul. I've come to preach to people in the room today. I don't care where you come from. I don't care what your motives are. If you can get baptized in the Spirit, God can take care of every evil thought. He can take care of every evil motive. And he can cut the strings of the adversary on your life. Somebody clap your hands. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. I think Paul also began to write the book of Romans. I don't want to get ahead of myself, but it's Paul who began to talk to man like a man that's bipolar in Romans 7. And he said, that what I do, that what I would do, I do not. And that what I would do, I. And he's going back and forth. Amen. He's talking about a puppet almost on a string, because my mental capacity says I want to do this, but it's like my body is pulled over here. And how many times are people in this room trying to do what is right, and all of a sudden the Instagram gets in your hand, and before you know it, you clicked on too many buttons. Hey, but how many have been on the website before you know it, I feel the Holy Ghost, and you went down too many channels? You didn't start out there. It's not the way you wanted to end, but somewhere, hey, the puppet is pulling the strings, and there's things being thrown at you, and there's, come on, those distractions being thrown into your life. Amen. I submit to you, there's people this morning, amen, that's come here to be, amen, washed in the name of Jesus and filled the Holy Ghost. But the whole time you're here today, the adversary's pulling the strings and he's trying to get you to do different than what your Holy Ghost, is telling you today. I want you to know you got to cut the strings off and say, I can lift my hands without wrath or doubt it. I can jump without the adversary's notice. I can run the aisles without him. Come on. There's got to be something in you. Wonder why we push worship. It's to make sure the strings are off of you. You wonder why pastor goes again on that song and the praise team sings another verse. It's not just to promote you to worship. Amen. So we get the glory. It's to shake the strings off and make sure my hands are still free and my feet are still free and my mouth. Come on. That's why you got to say amen and praise the Lord and hallelujah. You're making sure the strings, amen, are not controlling you. Honey, I'm a man that ought to be able to worship. And you're a woman that ought to be able to worship in the presence of God here today. Oh, somebody magnify him. Oh, too many people, amen, have I met in life, amen, that gave me a good story, but just a little while to be known that the strings are being pulled by somebody else. Come on, too many people, amen, have seemed to have, amen, good motives. And then you talk a little bit of time and you see the strings are being pulled by another person. Amen, I've been in negotiations on things and knew that who I was talking to was not in charge. Ever been to the car salesman and the car salesman tells you one thing, but really he don't have any power. You got to talk to somebody else and you're negotiating with someone that's not in the room and someone's pulling the strings left and right. And there's people that come and they're so used to feeling the tension of the core. Amen. They don't know what to do. They look around at people that are free and they can't even comprehend. They hear about people getting certificates. even for living without drugs. But the drugs has always been the string that held them together. Amen. Because when they were sober, they didn't like what it felt like. Come on, when the alcohol wore off, they just got a little bit more of it to help them put back together, because the strings held the tension. That's why when people come, my God, I feel like preaching today. That's why when people come to church for the first time, they look around and they think, what is it about these people? I'll tell you what it's about. When we got baptized in the name of Jesus, it began to cut every string. When we went down the only saving name of our Lord Jesus Christ, it took needles out of the vein. It took dope out of our, come on. It took dope out of the guns. It took crystal meth off the spoon. I'm going to preach a little while. It began to give us liberty like we never felt. We don't need a high to wake up tomorrow morning. We don't need another shot, amen, to get to work. We found something that's better. We cut the strings of the enemy. I said we cut the strings of the enemy. And now we can lift our voice. Now we can jump and dance. Now we're free. We've never felt like this in all of our life. Somebody praise him. I wonder if there's any free folk in the house right now. Come on, I wonder if there's anybody been set free right now. I wonder if there's a testimony that sin used to have you bound. I wonder if there's anybody had a Saul, Paul testimony that used to be dragged to this club and that club. That used to be dragged to this relationship and that relationship. That used to be dragged to this corner and that corner. But today you walked in here freely. Your hands were not bound. Your feet were not. Come on, I feel liberty in the Holy Ghost right now. I've come to tell you in the name of Jesus, he can set the captive free. Every now and then, there's got to be a pivotal moment. Amen, when they're on the road to Damascus. Amen, when you're some 150 miles. Amen, on your road. And you're just doing about, you're just going about your business. You're just going as ordinary as you have every day. And all of a sudden, because God, amen, loves you. And because God cares about, I know this is a little simple today. Amen, this is what I was burdened with last night and this morning. But somewhere on your walk and somewhere on your journey, God sees without the strings what you can look like. Amen, no Geppetto ministry for you. He don't want you just to be a puppeteer. Amen, we don't want to just pom-pom you into heaven. Amen, there's something about organic worship. I know we were Pentecostal. Amen, in experience, in apostolic, in doctrine. But we don't want just to say boo and everybody praise him. We don't want to hang up a sign and say applaud and everybody praise him at once. Amen, that's for the secular world. But there's something in you that comes from a combustible, amen, inner chamber of your heart that remembers what it used to feel like to lift the hand with the string and to lift the hand for the cigarette and to lift the hand with the alcohol. And now when you begin to lift up those hands, it's for a different reason. And now, and now when you walk into the house of God, you ain't here for another $50 to get to work tomorrow. You didn't come here for the food bank, but you came here because you knew, amen, that's where my help cometh from. It cometh from the Lord. Amen, now you're helping others. Now you're blessing somebody else. Now you're a part, come on, you're a part of discipleship others, because you know what it's like to live with the strings of the great power. Puppeteer the adversary. But today I've come to preach, there's hope. There's hope. There's hope for you today. In fact, I submit to you that if the only time you worship it was when somebody pulls the strings, you're in trouble. If the only time you pray is when someone pulls your string, you're in trouble. If the only time you worship is when someone pulls pulls a string, amen, like the back of a puppet, and there's a pre-recording. Even the Bible just talks about repeating the same old verbiage in prayer. Amen, I'm telling you, you're in trouble. But when you begin to worship, and there's something that new that comes out of that, and you begin to pray, and something new comes out of that, and you begin to fast, and something, come on, amen, exponential comes out of that, amen, you're starting to cut the strings off. You're starting to cut the strings off of your life. I feel like maybe you need a little more Bible for what I'm preaching today. Amen. Psalms 129 and verse 4. The Lord is righteous, and he hath cut, amen, asunder the cords of the wicked. I'm telling you, David even felt at times like he was being a puppet on a string. Even David, even going into enemy territory, had even decided to live there for a little while, being a mercenary for the, amen, the enemies of God. Amen. Seemed like he was just being driven, amen, not by his own, amen, intuition, but by a puppet, if you will, until fate finally David got in a prayer meeting, and he looked up to heaven, and he said, God, you truly have cut the cords asunder in my life, and now I do not worship, amen, to make the heathen happy, and now I do not make music, amen, to, amen, accentuate the kingdoms of darkness, but God, I've come to make music, amen, for the ears of heaven. I've come to work. I've come to preach to people in the room today. I don't know where you're at, but I feel like you're on your road to Damascus, and you are going down the wrong path. I preach you to a new convert. I preach you to a guest friend visitor here today. I want you to hear the preacher. Amen. There's a bright light shining today. Amen. It's the word of God. Amen. Can I tell you, the Bible says in heaven there will be no need for the S-U-N, because he is the light. There is no bearable of darkness in him. Amen. Can I tell you, he also said, you can't separate me from my word. Amen. His word became flesh. And so when the word of God is preached unto you, it's a light on the path of your Damascus. It begins to come alive and make anew. And today, if you've never been baptized in the holy saving name of Jesus Christ, the Bible said, what's the road to Damascus? Amen. Was come through by Jesus and a light. The next place we pick up was Paul was baptized. Immediately, the Bible says, after a few days, God began to speak to Ananias and began to tell him, there's a man coming, and he's already had a revelation, amen, that you're going to pray for him, and he's going to receive his sight. And when he gets done doing that, amen, Ananias began to argue, God, you don't know that's the man that used to have the strings attached to him? Do you not know the ramifications? Do you not know the family members that he used to persecute? Talk about the church. Amen, beat them senseless, if you will. And God said, I'm telling you, something happened on the road to Damascus. I began to cut the strings off of that boy. And I know you can't see it right now. And I know he was there when Peter was in court. And I know he was there when Stephen was stoned to death. But what you don't understand is, in the past, he was held by the strings of the adversary. But if he let me, I began to cut the strings off. Even the Bible says, once he got up out of that prayer meeting, he was immediately baptized. And then the next verse says he went out and started preaching. I want to tell you, that's a quick work. God's not trying to hold you over a barrel for the next 5 years. He's got a quick work for somebody to do today. He's got a ministry for you to do in the kingdom of God. But you've got to cut the strings. The puppet's got to look back and know, even the adversary's been playing games with my life and working me overtime. It's time I let God set me free for once and for all. Come on, somebody clap your hands. Education told him, amen, not to have anything to do with the Gentiles. Money told him not to speak the Greek language. Societal, amen, prejudices told him, amen, not to have anything to do with the people across the tracks. But something got a hold of him. He didn't care about their money, By the time God got done with him, it wasn't about education. It wasn't about their pedigrees. It wasn't about their learned, amen, knowledge. It wasn't about their biblical, amen, thesauruses and encyclopedias they began to read. Amen, when God got done with him, it was to every Jew and Gentile. It was to every bond, and I'm going to preach a little while. With God, come on, you know what happens when you get the strings plucked off your life? Prejudice has to fall off. Societal norms have to fall off. Well, I wasn't raised that way. I did that because you was raised in the world. But when you get baptized in the Spirit, how do you become a new creature? Old things are passed to it. Come on, get a little quiet on me now. Come on. Amen, Paul. You're not just going to get a revelation of truth. You're going to get a revelation of the way you think. You're going to get a revelation of societal norms. You're going to... Paul, when I get done with you, you're not just going to stop there. You're going to go to Rome. You're going to preach to the ex-inhabitors, slaves, even men of the system. You're going to preach to the vagabonds. You come on, read your Bible. You're going to preach to the prostitutes. You're going to preach, and God's going to say, I've got many people in this city. Why? Because when you get revelation at the strings that were holding you back, it made the way you think wrong. It made the way you dress wrong. It made the way your attitude... But when you start seeing the strings, it starts unraveling everything. I was raised on a false pretense. I was raised, come on, with a bias in my life. But once I got the Holy Ghost, I loved everybody. Once I got the Holy Ghost, I found truth. The Bible tells us at the end, amen, of Romans chapter 7. And pastor began to quote some of this, amen, in, amen, announcements. But in chapter 7, he ends with, oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the bondage of this death? And I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh the law of sin. My daddy was preaching today. I'm going to steal his example. But if my dad was preaching today, amen, he would talk to you, amen, about the man, amen, of Roman law, amen, that if he killed somebody, amen, that they would take the body of that individual and they would begin to strap it to the back of the man that killed him. If my father was preaching there, I heard him preaching much as a young man. Amen. But he would have to carry the load of that body. In fact, Roman law said, amen, that if a friend came over and cut the body off of you, amen, that man would have also the body put back on the original man. And then they would find another corpse and attach it to that man. And so his sin, amen, would be double for the mistake of trying to help another man. And the idea, amen, was that it would be a slow, cruel death to the man that had a corpse on the back of his body. I don't want to be grotesque here today, but he would put the body on his back. And it was meant that the liquids of that body, the putrid and the smell of that body would begin to rest into the living soul. The decomposing flesh, amen, where, amen, bugs, I'll say it for that, lack of a better word, began to eat the flesh, would then get into the body of the living man until the slow death and the weight of that sin or the weight of that body would begin to keep them. You see, when you've got the weight of something attached to you, amen, you can't get your hands up very high. When you've got the weight of sin on your life, it's hard to leap for joy because it got the weight of your past on you. And Paul says, oh, wretched man, who can deliver me from the body of this death? You see, you can take a bath in cologne and you can wear down the smell a little while, but you can't keep it off because a little while the smell's going to come back. Amen, you come to church. Amen, you bathe and amen, perfume and you bathe, amen, in cologne just to try to make sure nobody knows what you're really going. comb through, but give a little while and the smell starts coming back and death starts showing up and the putrid of sin even starts weighing you down to the point that you get down and you can't get back up. That was what the law was supposed to do, was to get them so bound in sin, even that they would never get back up. Think about 150 pounds of dead weight. Think about 200 pounds of dead weight on your shoulders. And a man that was living would be buried to death under a man of putrid and ill repute. Oh, but Pastor already quoted. Amen. He didn't stop there. He said, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit is life, and Christ Jesus had made me free from the law of sin and death. I tell you what Jesus does. He begins to cut the strings off. You couldn't pay the sin. You couldn't cut the puppet master off. But Jesus begins to cut it asunder. And he makes men that should have paid the price. And he makes women that were, come on, guilty. He begins to cut the weight of sin off of them. And now there's no condemnation. They can lift up their hands. They can lift up their voice. They can be baptized in the only saving name of Jesus Christ. They can worship again. They can run the aisles again, because God paid the price. I've come to preach to good people here today that God has paid the price for you. God has paid the price for you. I don't care what sin you think of today. I don't care what sin comes back to mind of your past. God paid the price. You can talk your way out of this, or you can start believing it today. You can have condemnation that comes from the world and comes from the adversary, but it don't come from God. You feel condemnation today, it's not from this pulpit. If you feel condemnation, it ain't from the choir today. If you feel condemnation, it ain't from the person sitting next to you, because you're looking at people that's been bought with a price. If you feel condemnation, that's by the sin and the world. But what you feel in this house is reconciliation. What you feel in this house, amen, is a second chance. What you feel in this house today, amen, is a strings being chopped, one service by another, one song by another, one preached word by another, one Bible study by another, and it just keeps cutting the strings until finally you can worship like you want to, until finally you can pray like you want to, and finally you can have church like you want to. I hope today that there'd be somebody that would shout when the devil told you no. I hope there's someone that can lift your hands when the adversary said keep them down. I hope there's somebody here today, amen, that can come to this altar in a few minutes when the devil said you don't deserve it. I want you to know God's cutting the strings. God's cutting the strings. It's time to realize that you're a free individual and God wants to do a great work in your life. Oh, somebody magnify him. I think we'll just love him right here. Come on, would you help me love him this morning? Come on, let's love him right now. Come on, I feel the freedom and the liberty of the Holy Ghost. Come on, musicians, come. I feel the liberty and the freedom of the Spirit right now. Hey, but that God's cutting some shackles off. Hey, but God's cutting some strings off. And he's letting people feel free for the first time. Stay with me. Just stand and stay standing. You've heard it's nothing new, but you've heard it with the elephants. They have learned that if they're going to train an elephant, that as a baby, they're going to hook a chain to their foot and shackle it to a stake in the ground and learn that when they feel the resistance, they can't pull away. And the older that they get, they start downgrading the mechanism to hold them down from being so visible to almost invisible. And they downgrade from the chain to a twofold rope, which they will hold the leg back. And when they feel the resistance, they stop and they won't run off, and they're always being controlled and manipulated. And to the point that they say that 25,000 pound beast, amen, they can tie a fishing line around the same pose and around that same gigantic leg. And when they feel the least resistance, the elephant will not move because it's been trained here to never go past its barriers. I'm preaching to people in this room today, amen, that you feel that same resistance that you've always felt. But today it's nothing less than just the strings of the adversary. You are so close to breaking that string that you don't even realize it today. And you feel just a little bit of resistance and you run back the other direction. You feel just a little bit of help and you run back the other direction because you don't even know what normalcy is supposed to be anymore. A family unit is so broken. Amen. A family of God seems out of place. Amen. A spiritual authority in your life has always taken advantage of your insecurities. But now when you see that in the house of God, amen, that string starts pulling back. It says, don't go that far. Don't buy in that much. Don't love that much. You don't know who's going to hurt you. I'm preaching to you today in the Holy Ghost, amen, that there's some strings, amen, that in this altar, the next few moments, that God can begin to cut, and God can begin to set loose, and God can begin to set free. I'm telling some, amen, I'm telling some people that are mighty in God. I'm telling some people that have a great future in the kingdom. I'm preaching to some guests here today. I'm preaching with everything I know to preach to you right now. Amen, I'm telling you, God's got great things for you. Amen, you can turn, amen, San Diego upside down. You can revolutionize this church, amen, with what God wants to do with your ministry and your heart. But you've got to be able to let God cut the strings and set you loose today. But in order for God to cut them, the puppet's got to look back and realize, I've seen the strings that's been attached to my life. His troubles come once I get the Holy Ghost?
Yes.
Does my money get funny at times? Yeah. But no more strings are attached to my life. Paul, you're going to have shipwrecks. You're going to be in prison. You're going to be beaten. Hey, man, you're going to have men lie on you. But I'll tell you what won't ever happen again in your life, Paul, is the strings of the enemy will never lock into your flesh one more time. The strings of the enemy will never grab a hold of your mind, not another day. From this day on, you may have to deal with life, but you ain't going to deal with the strings anymore. You may have to deal with this old flesh and drag it by the nape of the neck, as I've heard it, and take it back to the altar. But you're never going to deal with the strings that come from the puppet master of sin. Not one more day. Don't tell me the devil made you do it. My dad tells me of a story. I don't know why I'm on my dad today, but I remember a story my dad told me. My younger brother Justin was in the room. Rightfully, he deserved it. But he said that we were probably, I think I was 5 years old, and he said he just heard this blood curdle cry coming from the room, from Justin, just screaming at the top of his lungs. And he said he walked in the room and I was laying over the bed. And he said I had just hauled off and hit the thunder out of that boy. He said, Nathaniel, why'd you do it? He said, the devil made me. That devil might have made me do it a couple more times, but I got delivered. And Jesus had retribution for what I did, I promise you. You can come to service today and you can tell me that the devil made you sit in your pew. But there is no power The Bible says that the adversary is a prince and powers of the air. But the Bible says also that God is ahead of all principalities and the powers of the air. There is no wickedness. There is no devil in hell or out of hell. Come on. I feel a little bishop right there. Come on, that can keep you from getting where you want to get with God. I'm telling you today, if you might have made up mind, there's a Damascus road here today. And the light of glory has shone now. And you can make your way to Jesus. Don't stay in your pew. Don't stay in your sin. Don't stay in your iniquity. Don't stay in your shame. Don't stay in your sorrow. You make your way down to an altar and you say, God, I want to be free. I'm telling you today, you'll leave free. You'll leave changed. You'll leave with hope. You'll leave with a fresh start. Come on, I wonder now, there's some already making their way. I wonder if you start slipping out of your chair. I wonder if you start slipping out of your pew right now. I wonder if there's anybody want to be free today. Come on, would you come to this altar and would you let God set you free?
There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus.
I believe the Holy Ghost is going to help you today. Come on, I believe God's going to minister to you right now. Come on, it's time to break some chains. It's time to break some strings today. It's time to break the cruelty of the adversary that abides you in your mind, binds you in your worship, binds you in your heart. Come on, there's liberty here. Come on, it's the Apostle Paul who preached you who the Son has set free is free indeed. It's the Apostle Paul that gets up on Mars Hill and begins to declare and deliver to them a message, amen, that they never heard. Come on, you can be free, sir. You can be free, ma'am. You can be free, newcomer. You can be free, guest friend and visitor. You can be free.
There is power.
Someone to lift up in the name of Jesus. Come on, find someone to magnify. Come on, I give this flesh under subjection today. Come on, not another day, not another hour. I need freedom. I need liberty. I need freedom in the Holy Ghost.
Rising love. turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. Say you take what the enemy meant for evil,
and you turn it for good.
You turn it for good, Lord.
Oh,
you turn it all around.
Can we lift our hands and love him in this tabernacle? He's all over this place. Come on, pray in the Holy Ghost right here. Complete it, finish it. Put a stake in it today. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Somebody needs to pray and it's over, it's finished. I'm done, it's done. Somebody's evicting the enemy right now. You're out. You're not coming home with me. I'm cutting the streets. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm not living with this. Somebody needs to say that. I'm not living with this. We're going to pray one last time. I have not even had the chance to talk to Brother Harris. I'm not a man that is often given to dreams. It just doesn't happen. Earlier this week, it's as if God showed me, and it's more than one person, there was individuals, and it was like there was an army of clouds, and they were surrounding God's precious people. Lightning and thunder and rain and pressure was booming and shaking. It was more than one person. It was just, and it was controlling them. And I went to such a place of prayer, and I realized, and today I know that the Holy Ghost is against dysfunction. And you said it today, Brother Harris, domesticated spirits. I hope we heard that today. In Genesis, he was a serpent. Revelation, he was a dragon. When we domesticate the devil, when we domesticate the devil, he goes from a serpent in the dust to a lion in the streets. I wonder if there's anybody that's ready to pray. I really feel this in the Holy Ghost today. And you're going to leave this in the altar. Can I see your hand today? Are you bold enough? I'm leaving this in the altar today. I want us to pray. Come on, throw both those hands up and pray. And immediately their bands were loosed. Come on, Paul and Silas. And immediately the bands were loosed. Break every chain. Hallelujah. Come on, saints of God, we need to pray. God, help me. I don't want to domesticate things in my life and think that I can control them. Can I put fire in my bosom and not consume? Oh, God forbid. Woo! Thank you for the word of God today. Come on, somebody get bold. I'm not taking this home. I'm not living another day with this. Come on, somebody, say it with your voice. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus, I make this declaration today. I'm cutting the strings in the mighty, mighty, mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, there's somebody that's almost free, and the devil, he thinks he has you right. I'm not talking to visitors. I'm talking to saints right now. You're struggling. It's obvious. You're wrestling. You're the ship caught between two seas. Come on, we're going to pray one more time. God, I rebuke ambition. The Lord, rebuke ambition and self-thought, self-govern. I rebuke it. Lord, we must be careful when we invoke your name. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. You're the head of my life. Woo, created me a clean heart today. God, renew within me a right spirit. Let not there be any wicked way in me, Jesus. Cut the strings in my life, God. Oh, my Lord and my God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I believe that today is going to be a completed day after we get done tonight. It will come to even a further revelation. Before we go, remember that the puppet master is a slow motion hangman. and he's hanging you in slow motion. Because soon the strings slip from the back, from the hands, the feet, and they always end up around the neck. Jesus, thank you for this word from heaven. My heart is touched. I'm convicted. Thank you. Thank you for the word of God. Who am I, Almighty God, that thou art mindful of me? I'm just grateful that you would preach to the domesticated things of Pentecost that are killing mighty men and women. God, we've learned the art form of masking it with suits and ties, and the art of going to church and never becoming. I pray today for me, Lord, take me back to the old landmark. Take me to Calvary, where every tie was cut and every chain was broken. You said to be hot or cold, and today I choose to be on fire for you. I rebuke the attachment of the world. Take it from my mind and my spirit. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. And the church said, amen. You know what you feel right now? That's called conviction. Condemnation is not from God. Conviction is. You know what the beauty of conviction is, Brother Voss? If I can feel it, I can make it. Shake hands. Protect those that are praying. God's still moving this altar. Come early tonight. Bring somebody to church. God's going to fill them with the Holy Ghost. We'll see you here tonight for church in Jesus' name. Thank you, Brother Harris. Thank you, Jesus. Let's pray. If you got a fellowship, find the foyer. God bless you in Jesus' name.
Auction.